And we're back, everybody. I'm not going to say I'm sorry because frankly I don't give a shit, but your favorite podcast, The Naked Truth, has finally returned after what, a 2 week hiatus. I'm your host, Jed
King
Meshew of
Jared.
MMAfighting.com. Joining me is a man who was very confident in Yair Rodriguez and was proven to be a complete moron for all of that confidence. Mr. The Naked Gambler. TNG, how you doing?
Yeah, that's pretty much how I remember it too. I'm actually not doing too well because I was extremely confident in Yair, and now I just look like a fucking idiot. I mean, I remember vaguely that I think I said on the podcast that he'd be able to maintain the distance, he'd be able to get his kicking game going, he'd be able to avoid Frankie Edgar's takedowns. I think I remember the words extremely confident being thrown around, and well, it didn't turn out that way, so I guess I'm an idiot.
I mean, you're a super genius. We all know it. We've all accepted it. Sometimes a super genius can maybe overthink things, you know? It's okay. We're not going to hold it over your head, your terrible decision making in the Yair Edgar, because, if they fought tomorrow, maybe it's a whole different story. So we'll let you slide on
Telling
that one.
yourself that shit. Edgar'd smash him again. Keep telling yourself that.
There will be a point in time at which Yair Rodriguez would kick the shit out of Frankie Edgar. And when that day comes, sir, I'll have you know I will be there to let you know about it.
I get the feeling that if you aged Frankie Edgar like 30 years till he was in his mid-60s, and then just took mid-20s Yair Rodriguez and put him in against him, Frankie Edgar just old man strangle him on the ground. Just old man strength, drags him to the ground, beats the shit out of him, strangles him. I imagine that an old man Frankie Edgar would be a bit like Abdulmanap or Nurmagomedov, Habib's dad, where you just know that like you could put some mid-20s professional fighter in there and he's just gonna get fucking smashed by this old dude. No doubt
There's
about it.
no doubt in my mind that Abdulmanap Nurmagomedov would beat the shit out of like half the UFC roster.
Oh yeah, for sure. Can you imagine him versus like even Brandon Thatch or something? I don't think that's on the roster anymore, but that'd be a great fight, man. I could just imagine Abdulmanap just embarrassing the shit out of Brandon Thatch.
I mean, come on now, Brandon Thatch, he's the future, man. Do you remember when Brandon Thatch headlined a fucking UFC Fight Night event?
And to be fair, I mean, the hype was warranted. He beat Justin Edwards
Justin Edwards, who
and
didn't
Justin
Justin
Edwards on
Edwards?
TUF.
I was to say, didn't he just pick up the first win for Cody Garbrandt's team on Tough?
I
I
stopped
think he
watching
did.
Tough. I
I
stopped
don't
watching
watch
Tough.
it either, but I'm pretty confident Justin Edwards just got the first win, beating Joseph or for Cody Garbrandt's team. That's right, Garbrandt went like 0 for 7, but Justin Edwards just beat Joe Stevenson. So really, really strong effort there. So I mean, if you're beating that guy, you should definitely main event a fight night.
Yeah, indeed. I mean, it didn't go so well for him against good fighters, but you can't win them all. You can't win them all.
I mean, to be fair, he lost to Benson Henderson, Gunnar Nelson. That's very. And then Saiha
Yeah.
Bahar,
You left
that one,
out
that.
Hadrizada. You left him out because
Yeah.
that's a real bad one.
No, well, that
Although,
I was going chronologically.
shout out to Sayar Bahadurzada because the first time I ever saw him was in a UFC promo and I was watching with my friends and maybe it
Your
wasn't even a
friends.
UFC promo, maybe it was just okay. I was watching with acquaintances. I was stalking people and like hiding in their closet and reading their monitors, but
That sounds right. That
I
sounds
remember
right.
he was talking about how he walked over dead bodies. And me and my person I was stalking were just like sitting there wide-eyed listening to him talk about how he walked over dead bodies to get to school. And we were like, this is the most hardcore motherfucker I've ever seen. And then he just gasses in like 3 minutes and he's just completely worthless. I'm like, well, he still walked over dead bodies. I mean, that's still pretty badass, no matter how fast he gasses.
It is still gangster to be him, to grow up in. I mean, I guess maybe it's not gangster to grow up in a war-torn country, but
But to overcome it is.
yeah,
It's gangster as fuck that he got into the UFC when, like, as a child, he was walking over bodies to get to his school. Like, it's not the actual circumstances that are a gangster. Like, that's terrible. But the fact that he turned that into, like, being a professional athlete, that's incredible to me.
Professional athlete? We're talking MMA fighters or professional athletes?
Yeah, vaguely professional. I was reading on Twitter earlier, Timothy Bissell from Bloody Elbow was tweeting about Jermaine Durandamy, and he said that he was really uncomfortable.
He's a terrible person.
Yeah, he is, but all the Bloody Elbow guys are. They're really atrocious.
Total pieces of shit.
Couldn't agree more, my friend. Couldn't agree more. But he talked about how Jermaine Durandamy had a day job in the police force, and it made him uncomfortable that people were talking about how she should just instantly accept the fight with Cyborg. But he thinks that there's a good possibility that she simply doesn't think she can get enough training, the right kind of training, to fight Cyborg because she has a day job. And she fought Holly Holm while maintaining that day job. And asking her to fight Cyborg while she's working a day job is... Look, fighting Cyborg under the best of circumstances is rough. It's really rough. But when you have a day job and you can't even train properly, that's pretty fucked up.
All right. I'm gonna be honest with you here. I basically skipped over every article in the last few weeks about that whole thing. And I did that horrible thing that everyone does these days where I just read the headlines and then drew my conclusions all from that because I'm a real journalist. Yeah. There's no way that it doesn't, that it's, this is just, it's the worst optics ever. And there's just not, like, whatever Bissell's argument, that doesn't count to me. She's ducking Cyborg. And I never think fighters are ducking other fighters, but like,
I'm gonna call you out right now, motherfucker. Answer this question straight up. Is Demetrius Johnson ducking TJ Dillashaw?
Probably.
Straight up, yes or no? No. Yes or no?
Let me think on it for a second, and this will be bad radio.
He's turning the fight down and asking for Ray Borg. Even though the proposed fight is at 125, his division, he's asking for Ray Borg. You don't think he's ducking him? I think he's ducking him.
I'm saying no because... I think that he's trying to use it as leverage for more money. Now, if he's not, and he just is really thinks he wants to, then yes. If he's not using this as like a Nate Diaz style leverage move to get more money out of this, and I don't even know how he does get more money out of this. I know Dana said that this would be a pay-per-view, but this, I, how?
Yeah, exactly. Like Dana said that it'd be pay-per-view. That's what I was going to say. Yeah, he was going to get pay-per-view points.
And Dana says many things.
No, I
Dana
wasn't
says
that,
many though. Things, and they're never true.
I wasn't done with that thought. My main thought was like he probably instantaneously got offered pay-per-view points for a fight with Dillashaw, but then decided if he wants more money, he probably decided he wants more, and he's going to hold out. But I don't think that's it. He just wants to break the record, and he wants to do it easily and with very little trouble, and that's awful. Like, nobody should be in support of that. I've seen people justifying this on Twitter. Like, they say, well, he wants to break the record. That's what he's concerned with. If you're the champion and you're fighting weaker competition on purpose, how is Demetrius Johnson different than Michael Bisping if that's what he's doing? He's not. He's literally not. Except, there is a difference.
No, Michael levels Bisping, of degrees.
Yeah, exactly. Demetrius Johnson's worse. Michael Bisping fought someone who had already beaten him. And, like, now he's eventually going to fight Yoel Romero. He's at least fighting decent fighters. Like,
okay, he's never fighting Yoel Romero. He's never fighting Yoel Romero.
Probably, but there's a chance. But the thing is, like, at least he had a reason to fight Dan Henderson because Dan Henderson beaten him before and he wanted to run that one back. But what's Demetrius Johnson's excuse? He just doesn't want to fight TJ Dillashaw. He just wants to break records. And that's a good enough excuse for most people. Most people are fine saying, maybe not most people, but a lot of people are fine with saying, well, he wants to break records. Let him pick whatever opponent he wants. It's understandable to pick Borg. That's fucking bullshit. He's literally ducking TJ Dillashaw. And here's the worst part. You can say whatever you want about Jermaine Durandamy, but the only reason that she isn't getting away with this is because she hasn't built as much goodwill in the community as Demetrius Johnson has. And Demetrius Johnson's situation, honestly, is worse than Jermaine Durandamy's, because Jermaine Durandamy said that the only reason she agreed to go up to 145 and fight Holly Holm is because she was told that she would be allowed to drop back down to 135 afterwards. She was told that. And now she's deciding to do that. Like, they can't pin the division on her because she was never there in the capacity that the fan base seems to believe that she should be. This is the agreement she worked out with the UFC. Whereas Demetrius Johnson is turning down a fight with a legitimate 125-pound challenger in his weight division. What do you call that but ducking? That is literally ducking. GDR ducked Cyborg, Demetrius Johnson ducked TJ Dillashaw, and that's fine, but let's call it what it is. Let's just call it what it is.
There is a lot to unpack there, and I'm probably even going to forget some of the things I wanted to say, but to just kind of bullet point some thoughts out there in response to your tirade against Mighty Mouse, because you hate Mighty Mouse. We all know it. Everyone here knows it.
I
You're a
gotta
Mighty Mouse
say,
hater. You want to cut Mighty Mouse. We know. We
I
know.
gotta say, I like Mighty Mouse, but I'm glad to finally have an excuse to dislike him. A real one this time.
I know you do. I fucking know you do.
It's a good excuse, to
Sorry.
be
So,
fair.
look,
I mean,
it's a fine excuse.
this is the hardcore darling guy. Like, this is the guy who, the real fighter, the techniqueiest man to ever technique. Well, maybe the techniqueiest man to ever technique is only so fucking flawless and technical because he's fighting, like, Henry Cejudo, who's a few years into his career, Ray Borg, who isn't ready for him yet, Horiguchi, who isn't ready for him yet. He's Mayweather. He's like a broke version of Floyd Mayweather. He never wants to fight fighters in their prime. He
You
wants to
mean the
fight them
greatest
before.
boxer of all time?
In terms of matchmaking, Floyd Mayweather is very well known for his selectiveness when it comes to.
I know, I was hoping to piss you off by calling him the greatest boxer of all time.
I mean, he's up there, but Jesus, I shouldn't
All
even have
right.
said that. But
All right, so look, here are my basic thoughts, because in core concept, I probably agree with you, although it's hard for me to tell how much of it is you actually feeling this way and
I
how
can.
much of it is you latching on to an excuse to hate Mighty Mouse because it's your entire ethic distilled into one core concept. But if I don't stand even with Michael Bisping, I've never blamed Bisping for any of his decisions. I totally think Michael Bisping is making all of the correct career moves for himself. I campaigned for the Dan Henderson title shot because I thought it was funny. I hate the GSP fight, but I totally believe that if I was Michael Bisping, I'm damn sure trying to do the same thing. And I feel similarly here about Demetrius Johnson. I think that you are correct in that he's assessed that, yeah, I want to break this record, and it's way easier to do it against Ray Borg than it is TJ Dillashaw. And that's just the mental calculations. And so certainly by that definition, you can say he's ducking him. I will also say And I do think that some of the, when you talked about people are defending DJ reflexively, I'm sort of in that camp, but I'm not defending the actions. If the UFC wants to make this fight, I get, and he just is like refuses, I can't really defend that. That's some bullshit. But at the same time, I hate the idea that the UFC would make this fight purely because, and people have been firing off hot takes about it, but purely because TJ Dillashaw has never made 125 before. I do not know that he physically can or that he will even look good. Frankie, to my knowledge, and I looked it up, when this fight was first being bandied about, the only fighter who's ever dropped a weight class and gotten an immediate title shot without having to at least take a fight there beforehand, Randy Couture, I think, got it. But Randy Couture was not a large heavyweight. And he may have even taken a
Frankie
fight
Edgar.
before. And then Frankie Edgar, but in and Frankie Edgar was always a very undersized lightweight. Frankie Edgar could make bantamweight, and there's been a lot of talk about it. I have my interest in this fight is not that I'm not interested in this fight in general. If they were meeting it at catchweight, I'm super interested in it. And if they make the fight at 125, and I'm still likely interested in it, but there is the gray cloud of I don't have any fucking clue if TJ Dillashaw can make 125 if he looks like shit. 125 is the hardest weight division to make. It has by far the most people missing weight, and he's never fucking done it before. So maybe he can make it, but he just looks terrible because he sucks all his thing out, and then the fight also blows. So my issue is not. It, my issue in defending DJ is mostly that the UFC doing this feels like a. Like they're just out of fucking options. And I also think it's really, really stupid from a promotional standpoint to just throw away your bantamweight title challenger because, like, play out the best case scenario for me here. Yeah, we as, like, from a fan standpoint, we get an awesome fight and that's cool. Assuming that he can make weight and everything great, it's an awesome fight. But if DJ wins, you've just blown up a really good storyline for your young champion. Like the best title defense Cody Garbrandt has right now is TJ Dillashaw because that's a marketable storyline. You've just thrown that out the fucking window. And if Dillashaw wins, well, Is he going to stay at 125? I mean, maybe he would, but if he doesn't, then you've just nuked your 125 division just like on a fucking lark for, and Luke Thomas said this, and I agree with it, for a fight that means nothing to anybody. You and me will appreciate a Demetrius Johnson win. Nobody else is going to give a shit about him beating TJ Dillashaw versus beating Ray Borg. This isn't, if this goes on pay-per-view, like, why the fuck would the UFC put this on pay-per-view? It's going to do 200,000 buys, maybe. So I think it's promotionally stupid. And so strictly from that standpoint, I'm kind of on Team DJ. I always did, you know, I always felt that he was trying to use it as a way to leverage more money because he was fighting a tougher guy. But look, if you want to say he's ducking him and you compare him to Michael Bisping, okay, that's fine. I'll agree. Again, I don't necessarily like the outcome, but I do not in any way blame Michael Bisping or Demetrius Johnson for their actions here.
I'm just sick of their fans. Like the stuff
Demetrius
that
Johnson has fans?
Demetrius Johnson has such obnoxious fans because Demetrius Johnson fans are like the most educated people in the sport, and they use how educated they are to form really, really dumb emotional takes just like uneducated people do about Conor McGregor. And it's so weird to me. People reflexively defend Johnson no matter what he does. Criticism of Johnson is instantly deflected because he's a target that people don't want to see targeted because of how poorly he's been treated in his career. How good he is in relation to how well received he is, in relation to how paid he is, how well paid he is in relation to how esteemed he is. It's completely off. He doesn't get what he deserves, and so people want to defend him no matter what. But the fact of the matter is, he's this techniqueiest man to ever technique, this hardcore darling, this fighter's fighter, like a thinking man's fighter, all this. But at the end of the day, he's still selecting his opponents, which is no different to Floyd Mayweather. And a lot of the people who criticize Floyd Mayweather for deliberately selecting pre and past their prime opposition, that's exactly what Demetrius Johnson is doing. And he's always been doing it to some degree. Like, his title reign has been built on fighting guys before.
He's always been doing it. Now, that's disingenuous.
What I mean is, I don't mean always selecting his opponents, but always fighting people who are pre or past their prime.
No, that's fair, but there is a gulf of difference between Floyd Mayweather actively ducking anybody that could even fight him for real during his prime, and DJ.
How many fighters are there who could fight DJ for real? How many fighters can fight DJ for real?
I don't have any idea.
Not many. We agree there, but TJ is probably one of them, right? He's probably one of the ones with the best chance. Yeah. I'd favor
what
Johnson.
What I'm saying is, this is the one time Demetrius Johnson has ever. To my, and feel free to look something up and show me where he's ever had a hand in being like, no, I'm not going to fight that guy. The rest of it sort of fell to the fact that the UFC just matched him up against people that were ahead of the curve because they're pretty bad promoters in general.
Well, here's a counterpoint. Yes, it's true that he's not exactly selecting his own opponents, but look at the last opponents he's faced. His last opponent was Wilson fucking Hayes. His opponent before that was Tim Elliott, a tough winner. His opponent before that was Henry Cejudo before his prime. His opponent after that was John Dodson, arguably past his prime. But either way, like, I'm not going to sit here and criticize John Dodson. That's a good win. That'd be nitpicky of me. It's not a good win. Yeah. Kyoji Horiguchi before his prime. Chris Cariasso. Are you fucking kidding me? Like, how far back are you going to go? That's six fights. And we have one legit fighter in that period who is in his prime.
What I'm saying is the end result is the same, being that the end result of both DJ and Mayweather fought less than stellar opposition for swaths of their career. But the process is different in that DJ didn't intentionally not fight better fighters, but whereas Mayweather actively chose not to.
His entire field, Demetrius Johnson's entire field is of bad fighters. No, let me rephrase that. It's a weak division. And he's been fighting weak competition already. And it wasn't until he got that step up, potentially, in TJ Dillashaw that he turned around and said, oh, I'm not going to do it. He willingly fought weak competition. And then as soon as stronger competition came along, he declined it. He was given the opportunity to move up to bantamweight multiple times. And I don't blame him for not doing it because it's not worth the risk, considering he's probably not going to get... Yeah, and he's probably not going to get paid enough to move up to bantamweight. Like, they're not going to pay him $1 million to move up and fight Cody Garbrandt. Not right now, anyway. And I don't blame him as a result for not moving up to bantamweight. But the fact is, he turned down challenges at bantamweight. He stayed in the weaker division. And as soon as the weaker division threatened to become stronger, he refused to fight his new challenger. So we don't have enough data.
I'm just saying there's a difference between him doing it one time and he hasn't even technically done it yet versus Floyd Mayweather actually doing it a bunch of times.
That's because Floyd Mayweather had strong competition to choose from. Demetrius Johnson's only gotten one or two opportunities to do that. There's TJ Dillashaw. When's the last time you'd say he had an opportunity to do that? Like maybe Dodson, but he had already beaten Dodson.
I was about to say, if your criteria is just that he didn't want to fight good people, it would be the first Dodson fight, and then I would say the Benavidez fight. Because Benavidez beat him probably their first time they fought.
Well, he fought Benavidez for the title. Like, he was the inaugural championship tournament. He couldn't turn that down. Oh, the next Benavidez fight?
When he lamped him, because like he lost to Benavidez in that first fight. That's how I recall it, at least.
Maybe, but I also recall that you are the only media member who thought that Al-Hassan beat Omari Akhmedov. So let's not take your opinion.
I'm super proud of that. I'm cool with it. I'm super proud of that scorecard.
You're the new Adam.
In the year that I have been a media member, if you went back and checked the last year of MMA decisions, I guarantee you I have more fucked up scorecards than you'd put on that. And I am super fucking proud of that.
I remember back in the day, Adam Martin always used to be the guy who, he'd be the one dissenter in all the pages. And I love Adam Martin. He's one of the nicest guys in the entire MMA sphere. So I hope he doesn't hear this.
Akhmedov didn't do shit. He got a lot of takedowns. I knew he was going to win and I expected it. And I don't even have a problem with it. But Al-Hassan landed good punches when he was on his feet. Can't wrestle a lick. Totally fair. Akhmedov did shit when he got him down, though.
Yeah, that's fair enough.
That's my story. I'm sticking to it.
Yeah, I can't even fault you there. So UFC 212 is coming up. Moving swiftly on from Omari Akhmedov, because that's not...
I was about to say, we spent a bunch of time talking about Demetrius Johnson, which I had no intention of doing, and we didn't even talk about Jermaine Durandamy and Chris Cyborg. Just one last thing before we jump to 212, and you don't have to go long. Do you think Jermaine Durandamy is ducking Chris Cyborg? Yes or no? I just want the bare bones brass tacks answer.
Yes, but... But it's the same kind of ducking that I employ on you. It's strategic ducking. And it's part of a broader game plan that's actually very courageous in context. It just seems kind of cowardly out of context.
Please show me what the courageous in context is.
Well, that would require revealing my game plan, which would be highly unprofessional. So, but just trust me, my game plan in the broader context can only be described using words like valorous, valiant, courageous.
Fair.
Any synonym of courageous, whereas in a narrow context, my individual actions may appear cowardly or spineless or yellow-bellied.
Part of the bigger picture.
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay, well then moving on, because we, for the first time ever on this show, are going to actually keep it within a relatively brief timeline. Look at us go. We're so professional. UFC 212 coming up this weekend with what I assume will be the fight of the year in the main event. The co-main event is a sensational matchup between two of the best five strawweights in the world, except for it's a bullshit fight. We'll get to that later. Two of the best three. We'll get to that in a second. Because I think it's two of the best four.
No,
I'm not. I sort of think
you can't
Andrade
be talking about
Andrade. Kovacic.
Oh my god, you are talking about Andrade. I thought you might have been talking Andrade about Kovacic.
Oh no. Oh, I see. I mean, no, because it's the Kovacic loss. Thugros is just too fresh. But like within a year, Thugros might be able to beat Carolina in a rematch. I don't know. It's questionable. We'll get to that anyway. This is a card that's filled with mostly shit and is very top heavy. But the main event is, has every chance and possibility and opportunity to be the fight of the year and one of the best fights we've ever seen. I know you wrote a technical breakdown for champions.co on it either today or yesterday. I just read it today. Jose Aldo, the sort of UFC featherweight champion versus Max Holloway, the sort of UFC interim featherweight champion.
To give some context on this fight, the background of it is basically that it's part of a four-man tournament, and the first fight of that tournament was Eddie Alvarez versus Dustin Poirier, and that they're going to have a rematch to sort of sort out the tournament, and then the winner of Holloway versus Aldo is going to fight the winner of Alvarez versus Poirier, and then the winner of that's going to get a chance to rematch McGregor. It's like a redemption tournament for everyone who's ever been defeated by McGregor.
Except for there's zero chance Conor McGregor fights MMA again. That's my hot, that's my hot take for this week. I think Conor McGregor's done with MMA.
I'd like to see him go into WWE.
It's totally possible, but we don't need to get off track on Conor McGregor because we're trying to be fucking professionals for the first time in our lives. Jose Aldo, Max Holloway, you wrote a wordy, shitty breakdown of a main event where you forgot to mention all of the important things. So tell me, what are your, you know, before we even get into the specifics, how's this fight make you feel?
Thick and fully erect.
I would have chosen a little beefy, more family friendly.
Meaty, erect, just throbbing, bulbous. Yep, that about sums it up. Vascular.
See, I'm the opposite. This is one of the, like, I know that this fight is basically peak MMA, and it hurts my soul because I know the end result, and I'm not happy about it. But why don't you tell me how do you envision this fight breaking down? Give me a pick if you're feeling saucy about it. Tell me the important takeaways.
First, I'll tell you how you envision the fight going down. You think that Holloway is going to make it look surprisingly easy and is going to make Aldo look really, really bad, and Aldo's finally going to look like an old man, right?
Well, no, I don't think that. Really? I know that because Jose Aldo's really shitty because he got knocked out in 13 seconds and only a fucking chump does that.
Yeah, that's true. I can't argue with
you there. Max Holloway made 15 minutes and Jose Aldo couldn't make 15 seconds.
Yeah, but fucking to be fair, Conor McGregor was suffering from a serious injury in that Holloway fight. I believe he ruptured his entire spine. Pretty sure that was it. Just all his spinal discs were broken. He was practically paralyzed and he still won the fight.
Or it's just that Jose Aldo's bitch made. Maybe that's what it is.
It could be both. It's not an either or situation.
It's true. Little of column A, little of column B.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's my very technical and professional breakdown of this main event. Jose Aldo's bitch made and Max Holloway is not. And so that's the game. What about you?
In my mind, I'm pretty confident in Aldo, and in my heart, I'm pretty confident in Holloway, because I hate saying this, but it just kind of feels like Holloway is going to win. It just sort of makes sense that Holloway would win. I don't know why. It feels inevitable, but at the same time, technically, here's the thing. They're both defensive masters, and the big issue for Aldo is going to be initiation.
Not a defensive master. He got knocked out in 13 seconds. He's bitch made.
If anyone wants to be the co-host of a podcast, just hit me up on Twitter. But I think
you also have to be the producer, so just be aware of that, guys.
Yeah, and you also have to, like, get me to do the podcast, which is way more difficult than it sounds. Way more difficult. It almost
in
didn't
general,
even happen
yes.
today.
To be fair, a lot of our last absences involved me being too drunk. So
I'd be right there with you, man. After
but
you
previously, it is his fault.
Yeah, there have been lots of cases where it was my fault. We were supposed to do a super intoxicated post-fight podcast for, was it 2:11?
Yeah, it was 2:11.
Yeah.
And I was too drunk to do it.
Yeah, I was just too drunk. High as fuck. I was ready to go. I was like, Jed, are you ready to do the fucking podcast? And you're like, no, man, I need to go to sleep.
I hadn't slept in like 3 days and was hammered. It was just like, this isn't going to happen. Going to bed. Bye.
Yeah, probably a good idea that that never happened. We're probably at our best when we're sober, if we're being honest.
We'll find out. Maybe I could do a post fight for this one. This would be,
yeah.
We can talk all about how Jose Aldo got nuked by Max Holloway 25 seconds in.
It's very possible, man. There's my no big thing with that fight happens. Is that it's possible. It wouldn't shock me. It wouldn't shock me no matter how the fight went, to be honest. I wouldn't be very surprised if Aldo finished Holloway, but I do think it's most likely to go distance pretty confidently, but I wouldn't be surprised no matter what happens in this fight. It's just one of those fights. My big thing is that I think Aldo's going to have trouble with his engagements because Holloway is amazing at choosing when and how to engage. And I think that Aldo's best option here is to fight a little bit like he did against Chad Mendes, because Holloway's not going to just stand in front of him. Holloway's going to actively move away in a way similar to how Mendes did. He's going to check leg kicks. He's going to try to choose his spots, but he's going to do a better job of it than Mendes. And Aldo is exceptionally good even at chasing down people like that. Like the way that he fought Mendes was he amped up the aggression, pinned him backwards, he started throwing more left hooks to the liver, he started when Mendes would hand fight, he'd start just throwing his right over the top to open up opportunities for everything. He's a master everywhere, and he's equally proficient in the pocket as he is at range. And if he can consistently force Holloway into a space that's advantageous for him, then he'll win. But Holloway has just been the master of never letting that happen since he lost to McGregor. Nobody's forcing Holloway into bad positions. When have you seen Holloway rocked, even? I mean, it's really rare. The only time he even comes close to a dangerous situation is when he chooses it, like in the Ricardo Lamas fight. And even then, nothing happened to him. He stayed safe, even though he deliberately entered the danger zone and just swung.
That was awesome.
Oh, yeah. One of the best moments in that
match. I just wish that's all that ever happened.
Yeah. One of the sport's finest moments.
So, all kidding aside, I actually sort of agree with your general feelings in that my head says Jose Aldo, my gut keeps telling me Max Holloway, but I can't tell if that's like a vestige of an old thought I had. So I'm going to run this. I'm going to run my view by you. Give me your thoughts. Originally, like as Max Holloway was on his come up, I started thinking like, oh shit, this dude's going to fuck up everybody. And then on his last fight, honestly, the Anthony Pettis win, I know he beat the shit out of Anthony Pettis in the third round, but watching that, I thought, and I rewatched that recently, he is a slow starter, and he just looked much more exploitable in that fight than I sort of remembered in my recollections of him just charging and thumping up people and like busting up Ricardo Lamas and all those types of things. And so my head says that, a piece of my head says, just on like the idiot caveman level, well, Max Holloway throws a lot more offense than Jose Aldo, and he is also an exceptionally talented defensive fighter. And so strictly on winning points and volume, Max Holloway's going to win. But my head starts thinking, and I can't tell if I'm overthinking this from that Max Holloway's never really been great at checking leg kicks. Jose Aldo, everybody talks about it, he's super fucking good at kicking people's legs. But also, the thing that really has made me kind of choose Aldo as the actual victor here, even though I'm pretty confident that I'm going to be fucking wrong and Max Holloway's going to get the belt because that's just how I live my life, is that Chad Mendes fight, I think people forget just how fucking good Jose Aldo is. And like, it's hard to forget because he stunned Frankie Edgar in the most like demoralizing way possible, but he did it in like first gear. Like he just beat the shit out of Frankie Edgar without even trying. And in that second Chad Mendes fight, we saw him have to try at stages. And so in my head, I'm just like, Jose Aldo has depths to his game and, you know, gears and degrees with which he can ratchet up his offense and be this beastly fighter, and we don't ever see it because he just finds the level above his opponent and then just stays right there and spends most of his career coasting. And it's hard to say coasting because he's so proficient, he's so good, and he's just beating the shit out of everybody in these ways. But it does, and it feels a little bit like the way George St. Pierre would do it, only instead of taking people down, Jose just doesn't let you land clean on him and, you know, hit you with a bunch of hooks and a jab.
Yeah.
And so in my head, I think Max Holloway is going to be the guy that brings out those deeper layers to his game, but ultimately still falls short of the technical kind of superiority and brilliance. And the fact that he starts so slow, I think Aldo's gonna win the first, and if he can bank some leg kicks in the first before Max starts building, and he can win the first kind of two rounds just sort of on his thing, then it becomes on Max to really start pressuring. And while he's an excellent, you know, he's excellent at pressuring, he's a very good forward fighter, Jose Aldo is an exceptional at everything. He's exceptional at countering and working around that, and his footwork. So
he's the best technician ever.
I mean, I can't argue that point. I wanted to just for posterity's sake. But yeah, so in my head, I think Jose just has a little bit more depth of skill, and I don't think he's any way diminished. And so I'm picking him to win. But my gut just tells me that Max Holloway is going to come out and just beat him up because the MMA gods are cruel bastards.
Yeah, that's how I kind of feel too, and my God, is that it's a sort of passing of the torch sort of deal. But I'd say that there's more than a slight technical gap in terms of the depth of their skill sets. Jose Aldo isn't necessarily so skilled that Holloway can't beat him or beat him decisively on the feet, because he can. Holloway's that good. But when you're talking depth of skill, nobody's skill is as deep as Jose Aldo's. His defensive skill, his offensive skill, everything that he does is so ridiculously deep.
Like, excuse me, Demetrius Johnson, let's not forget we just spent 20 minutes talking about him.
I'll slap you right now. There are things that Demetrius Johnson does better than Aldo. He's probably better in the clinch, and almost definitely better in the clinch. But other than that, I mean,
way better at ducking opponents.
True. Slightly better offensive wrestler than Aldo. Only slightly. Aldo is an amazing offensive wrestler. Anyone who disagrees.
I'm not even entirely sure that's accurate.
As in, you think Aldo might be as good?
As in Aldo, yeah, Aldo might be as good.
Yeah. Aldo's definitely a better defensive wrestler. I don't want to see anyone arguing that.
There's nobody on the planet of Earth that Aldo isn't a better defensive wrestler than.
Exactly. And not only that, there's nobody on planet Earth who Aldo isn't a better defensive striker than. His defensive striking is, it doesn't even make sense how little he gets hit clean for as many opportunities as he gives his opponents to hit him clean. You know what I mean?
Yet, 13 seconds.
Yeah, like I said, if you're looking to co-host the podcast, just come at me on Twitter.
It's the perfect trump card. Just bam, 13 seconds.
I can't even say anything except that I'm getting a new co-host who won't do that. That's the only way. That's the only counter argument, is to just find another co-host who won't make that argument.
I'm sorry, I'm bringing the real, you know. Joe Rogan taught me all about it. Blame it on Joe Rogan.
His legacy is definitely diminished by the 13-second KO, but fuck you.
I derailed your exposition about Jose Aldo being the best defensive striker of all time.
Yeah. I just wanted to wax poetic about Jose Aldo for a few minutes, and you're like 13 seconds.
Please wax poetic on his defense.
Okay. I'll just be broad and quick about it. Jose Aldo is the greatest defensive fighter of all time in every single phase. He is the greatest defensive wrestler of all time. He's the greatest defensive striker of all time. Nobody does defense like Jose Aldo. And frankly, not a lot of people are even close. Demetrius Johnson isn't close. Demetrius Johnson's there to be hit. He moves more than Jose Aldo, but he doesn't have as good footwork. He doesn't have as good head movement. He doesn't have as good parrying, blocks, nothing. He doesn't do anything defensively as well as Jose Aldo does. He does some things offensively better, especially in the clinch, but defensively, he's not comparable. And so when people talk about Demetrius Johnson as if he's this perfect fighter, honestly, I think a lot of that comes down to what I call the quickness bias, where smaller men always appear more technical because they're moving faster. Have you ever noticed that? A lot of people confuse speed with technicality. Like, if someone who's moving their feet quickly is considered to have good footwork, even if they don't really have good footwork. And Demetrius Johnson has really good footwork, but because of the
speed... I call that the Joe Rogan bias.
Yeah,
quite possibly. Because Joe Rogan does that shit all the time.
Oh, I couldn't agree more. It's awful. But Jose Aldo has better footwork than Demetrius Johnson. Jose Aldo has the best footwork in MMA history. No doubt. He does.
Alexander Gustafsson.
That's a great example of the quickness bias, because Alexander Gustafsson is really, really fast for his division, and so he looks like he has good footwork because he's moving around fast. But he doesn't. He has awful footwork. He's constantly getting himself out of position. He's constantly having to turn and run away because he doesn't know how to circle out properly. It looked a lot better.
Running and running away is good footwork.
So then why do you keep calling me a coward and not a defensive mastermind for ducking our fight?
Because I'm still picking a fight. I'm not trying to compliment you.
Well, if you can't deal with my defensive footwork, then why would you try to pick a fight with me?
The first rule of fighting is never fight unless you know you're going to win. And so Alexander Gustafsson just runs away when he knows he's not going to win. And it's brilliant footwork.
Yeah, true. I mean, in that case, Demetrius Johnson docking TJ Dillashaw is the best footwork he's shown in his entire career.
It's true. See, he's still getting better. That's the thing about him. He's only 30 and he's still getting better.
He gets better every time out. It's amazing to think about.
Okay. So we've talked about the main event and we just spent some time. Both of us are picking Aldo and pretty confident we're going to be wrong. But we just spent time talking about Jose Aldo's great defensive technique. So let's talk about perhaps the second best defensive fighter in MMA. Karolina Kowalkiewicz is taking on Claudia Gadelha in the co-main event. That's a really quality segue right there, guys. I just want you guys to know.
So for the record, by the way, just before Jed gets onto this, unless there's something that Jed really wants to cover, we're going to cover two more fights on the main card. I'm going to point out the other one in a minute because I'm very excited to talk about it. And we're going to answer some questions just to make sure. I just want to make sure we get the questions in because people were bitching. Yeah, we took a few weeks off, guys, and your questions were shit. They were really bad. They weren't even serious questions. Why would you think we'd answer them?
It's true. We're two fucking super geniuses, so bring something real or we're going to knock it 30 rows up. You know?
Yeah, exactly.
I'm excited to find out we're talking about two more fights on the main card because I got one and one undercard fight I could talk about if you felt compelled to, but sweet. So the co-main event, Claudia Gadelha, the consensus second best strawweight in the world, is taking on Karolina Kowalkiewicz, who the most recent formal title challenger and is currently the third best, though Jessica Andrade looming. She's looming, and so is Thug Rose, who just looked really impressive beating up an atomweight. So,
yeah.
But essentially, the co-main is to determine who's the best strawweight that's not named Joanna Jędrzejczyk in the world. What do you got on this one? Because all my thoughts on this fight basically don't have anything to do with the fight itself. So why don't you tell us your feelings, team?
I know those exact thoughts. Karolina is cute, but Claudia is bae. She is, oh my God. What are we even, that booty? What are we even doing here? A booty like that should be outlawed. Outlawed, I tell you. How am I supposed to take combat sports seriously if there's a booty like that in the cage? Like, what am I going to look at? I'm a human being.
I love that that's where your head went, because it was not what I was going to talk about. Although, I do think Claudia Gadelha has a legitimate case to be the single most attractive person in mixed martial arts, male or female.
No, yeah.
I think the other contenders for that are Luke Rockhold,
me,
Carlos Condit. You're not really an MMA because you keep ducking me. But yeah, she is a 10 and a half for damn sure. So other than that and Claudia Gadelha's booty, what are your thoughts on this fight?
It's a one-sided smashdown for Gedalia. There's very little to say here. She should be better literally everywhere and should be able to do whatever she wants, no matter where the fight goes. Shouldn't be competitive. Carolina shouldn't win a round, and her any stamina advantage she should have shouldn't come into play. I think that Gedalia easily 30-27s her, just like she's done lots of women, and makes it look utterly uncompetitive, and Karolina Kowalkiewicz is removed from the title scene because, oh, she got easily stomped by Gedalia, just like everyone else does.
I'm excited to hear you say that because I disagree. I don't disagree that Gedalia is going to win. She's totally going to win. Let's be very fucking clear on that. My real takeaway from this fight is that the fact that this is three rounds is bullshit, and I hate it when you've got the number two and three best fighters in a weight division fighting and they're fighting for 15 minutes. What the fuck are we even doing here? Just fuck all the way off. That's garbage. They need to fight 25 minutes. And that's the fact that it's three rounds wildly advantages Gedalia, because the book's out. Like, she gets tired. If Kowalkiewicz had any chance to win, it would be in a 5-round contest where her stamina could, you know, come into play. I do think Kowalkiewicz is probably going to win the third round because I don't think Karolina Kowalkiewicz is even a really good fighter. I will even say, like, she's really not a very good fighter. But what Karolina Kowalkiewicz is she's gritty as fuck. Like, nobody talks about it because she has this, like, angelic face and she doesn't say a lot and she's super, like, happy, and she has that little, like, quiet smile, and she bounces and, like, rests up against the cage at the beginning of every round with her hands behind her back. But there are few people in fighting that are just rugged. Like, she is fucking shoe leather tough, and she finds ways to win. Like, Thug Rose was beating her ass in their fight, and then Thug Rose got into a clinch one time and Kowalkiewicz beat the shit out of her, and then she was like, oh, I'm just going to keep doing that for the remainder of the fight, and then she won the fight. I just have a lot of belief in her grittiness and her, you know, that sort of intangible way that she can just win rounds and win portions of a fight despite really not having any technical advantages. And I'm with you. I think for the first two rounds, certainly Claudia Gedalia wins every phase of the game. But I do think Kowalkiewicz can make her work in clinches. If Gedalia stays at range and just boxes with her, she's bringing way more power, and Kowalkiewicz gets hit way too often. So despite her volume advantage, like, Claudia Gedalia is going to win those exchanges. But I think Gedalia is going to try and grind, going to spend some time in those clinch exchanges where Kowalkiewicz will have some good knees and some good elbows and sort of chip away. I think she's going to take the third after Gedalia slows down a bit, and she's just going to take the third on kind of shitty striking volume and some good work in the clinch. And if it were five rounds, I would really, really love this fight. But because it's three, I feel very confident Gedalia is going to win.
Yeah, it seems simple enough. And I like how they have that sort of theme going where, you know, the co-main event is between the number two and number three strawweights in the world. So the main event is between the number two and number three featherweights in the world.
I see what you did there. I respect it.
And the third fight down is between the number two and number three legend weights in the world, which is the fight that I meant to talk about, because you
of course said it that, was.
Yeah,
of fucking course it was.
Of course it was, because you said that the main event is the most MMA fight possible. And to me, Vitor Belfort versus Nate Marquardt is the most MMA fight possible. It is the
pinnacle of
MMA.
If I said it was the most MMA fight possible, I misspoke. And what I meant to say, it was the best MMA fight possible. I concur that Belfort versus Marquardt is probably closer to the most MMA fight possible.
Yeah. Phil Brooks versus CM Punk and Dada versus Kimbo might, they're in the running too. But 60-year-old Nate Marquardt versus 70-year-old Vitor Belfort.
Phil Brooks versus CM Punk.
Is that what I said?
Yes.
Okay, let me rephrase that. What's his face versus Mickey Gall? There you go.
I don't know. Phil Brooks shadowboxing for 15 minutes is pretty fucking MMA too.
Both those guys fought Phil Brooks and they got submitted in the first round. Or not Phil Brooks, Mickey Gall. I did it again. Fuck.
I'm so shit at this. It's amazing.
All right, we're not going to talk about that. Edit that part out.
Okay, so we're talking about Vitor Belfort in what may be his retirement match, but apparently isn't his retirement match anymore, and it's not even going to be his last UFC fight because he still has one fight on his contract.
And he might even have five more, he said to Fierce Savvy.
Yeah, God, he's... Oh, God. What a special guy Vitor is. So, let's talk about the most MMA fight, certainly on this card, Belfort versus Marquardt.
Yeah, and what they've effectively done here is they've performed a genius, just a stroke of genius, where they've taken two former TRT users who are both just near death, pretty much. They're as unathletic as they're ever going to get. They've aged 20 years, pretty much, in the course of 1 or 2 years. They have no durability between them. They can be easily stopped. Marquardt more so than Belfort. Belfort, actually, one thing on Belfort real quick before I rip into him, because I'm going to rip into him, but I just want to give him some credit for the Kelvin Gastelum fight, where it was the only time in my entire life that I've thought, wow, Vitor Belfort is really tough. The only time. I've never thought to myself that Vitor Belfort fought with a lot of heart, because he doesn't, but in that particular fight, just once, he did. Just hey. Once... He had to he be fought, forced to stop.
He fought the new hotshot guy to a no contest, so that's pretty impressive at his advanced age.
Yeah, that's true. Although Nick Diaz did the same against Anderson Silva, which is why Nick Diaz is the premier legend and potentially the greatest of all time of MMA.
Oh, do you think we can get a Belfort versus Nick Diaz fight? Is that,
oh God,
is that in the offing?
Please, please give me that. Oh, that'd be wonderful.
That's the first time I've ever thought of it, but I'd watch the fuck out of that.
That would be amazing. If you want to do a real Legends weight division, just stick Nick Diaz in there with like six old men in a row. Give him Belfort first. Give him the Anderson rematch. Fuck it, give him the Condit rematch. Condit's chin is gone now. Nick Diaz can knock him out, no problem.
Carlos Condit's not stupid, and Carlos Condit's going to stay retired.
Probably. That's the only reason I think his chin is gone anyway, is because of his own comments and probably his own intelligence, because he said he got rocked by Maya, which, fair enough, he admitted it straight up. I got rocked by Maya. My durability probably isn't that good anymore. Yeah, buddy, you're a real smart guy for saying that.
Underestimating Demian Maya. Maybe we're underestimating the power mitts of Demian Maya.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, he knocked out Stun Gun.
He's a ferocious guy. T Wood better watch out. He might get outstruck by Demian Maia. Wouldn't be the first time Tyron Woodley got outstruck by a fucking jiu-jitsu player.
And Demian Maia is a way better striker than Jake Shields. I mean, Demian Maia outstruck Jake Shields for large periods of their fight. If anything, Maia should have the advantage on the field in terms of technique. It's just everything else.
Good God. Our show is the best.
Here's a good question for you. You might favor Tyron Woodley on the feet over pretty much every welterweight on the roster, but is there a welterweight on the UFC roster who you would describe as a worse technical striker than Tyron Woodley?
There have to be.
There have to be, but you really have to think about it. I mean, Matt Brown's better than him. Even though you'd favor him to knock out Matt Brown if it's set in the feet, Matt Brown's a better striker. Let's be real. He'd beat Cerrone on the feet too, but Cerrone's a better striker. There's lots of guys who are better strikers than Woodley. But
that's the thing about Woodley, though.
Yeah, he's terrible. That's the thing about him.
He is. He's. I believe Tyron Woodley can beat any welterweight alive. I also think that there's a much lower floor of people that could beat him just because he might just shit the bed.
Like, yeah.
He might just do nothing for 25 minutes and lose a stupidly shitty decision to them.
Although doing nothing for long periods of time actually seems to be working out for him, because he beat Gastelum doing that. He beat Thompson doing that. And I mean, MMA is a game of hit and not get hit. But what if you cannot hit and not get hit and still win?
And there are levels to this game, and exactly. Tyron Woodley is playing them.
Exactly. Like you have your base level players who are just kind of dicking around, swinging bombs, your Just Bleed guys. And then above them, you have your way above them, you have
Julian
your
Lance.
Sure. And then way above them, you have your GSP and Aldo types who decide they're going to hit you. They're not going to get hit back. They're going to control the pace. Beautiful. And then above them, you have Woodley types who are like, I'm not going to hit you. You're not going to hit me, but I'm going to outpoint you. And then above them are your Demetrius Johnson types who say, I'm not going to hit you because I'm not going to fight you. Bye. And then they run away.
See, he's playing the game on a whole different plane of existence.
Yeah, he's a level four MMA player.
I actually forgot there is a level five we should talk about. You don't fight anybody because you get suspended for running over people with a car or failing for drug tests or doing cocaine off hookers and sandblasting them or whatever it is that John Jones is playing at.
Sandblasting.
Because that's really sandblasting hookers. That's really that's the level five MMA experience when you're sandblasting hookers.
Yeah. In my defense, I wouldn't really call it sandblasting. Unless you weren't talking about me, in which case, edit out that last part.
Okay, but let's talk about Belfort Marquardt, because for some ungodly reason, you have thoughts on this. I have none. This is a fight that's happening. It's going to be awful and great.
This is one of those fights where I got this buddy of mine, one of my best friends, and he's into MMA, very into MMA. He's been watching it pretty much as long as I have. And there are certain fights that I always make sure he watches with me. The last one that I can recall is Arlovski versus Ngannou. And this is going to be the next one. There's definitely been some since then, but this is going to be the next one. This is the fight. This is the kind of fight where you watch this and you're laughing before the fight even starts. And then once the fight starts, you are dying. You're just dying. You can't stop laughing for the entire duration as one old man kills the other old man. That's the kind of fight this is. Like, say, CB Dolloway versus Nate Marquardt was the same. We watched that fight together for the exact same reason. We were laughing the entire time because it's so bad. It's just so bad, but it's so good. And we were sure CB was going to win that fight.
Which old man do you think is going to kill the other one?
I think Marquardt isn't as shot as people think he is, but he's probably still going to lose because I think Vitor is more durable.
That's fair. That's my basic breakdown of this fight is Vitor is not shot for about 3 minutes, and then he's only kind of shot if you just put him under pressure, and then he'll wilt like the delicate flower that he kind of is.
Yeah.
And Nate Marquardt just doesn't have a chin anymore, and so that's probably I also think there's a non-zero chance Vitor just like eats all of the TRT in the next 2 days. Just says, fuck it, it's my last ride, I don't give a shit.
He shows up looking like Tyron Woodley.
Just
the power punching scene.
If he just came out and was like, yeah man, I knew I was retiring, so I Brock Lesnar'd this shit, I did all the things I could get my hands on, what are you gonna do, suspend me? I'm retired, fuck off.
To be honest, that's the kind of thing I could sincerely see myself doing if I were an MMA fighter, especially if I were a disenchanted MMA fighter who wasn't happy with how they were being treated by the organization. I think 100%. It'd be hilarious. I honestly think that if I were in Vitor's position, just like, juice to the gills, you come into the fight looking like fucking prime Arnold Schwarzenegger, and everyone's like, oh, and you pass your pre-fight drug tests because random drug tests are very hard to actually, it's very hard to actually catch someone. You fail your post-fight drug test, but who gives a fuck? Who gives a fuck?
Dude, there's absolutely. And then if I still want to fight, okay, I'll just go fight in Japan. That's fine.
Yeah, exactly.
Ryzen's awesome. I'll go fight in Ryzen. It'll be great. Have you seen photos of Krokop? That dude is definitely back on.
And that's great. He should be.
It's fucking amazing. I'm so for it.
I am as well, 100%. And like, the best part is that, you know, you could totally imagine Vitor Belfort shows up looking like prime Arnold Schwarzenegger and Nate Marquardt just like, oh, there's something going on here. But there's nothing he can do. They both know that Vitor's used to the gills and nothing he can do. And he just has to go out there and get hit by the spinning wheel kick of TRT Jesus and just flatten into a fucking pancake.
I wish we didn't have the Reebok deal. I mean, for many reasons, but so if like Vitor could take a bunch of TRT and then be sponsored by like a TRT brand or whatever, just get like a steroid sponsorship on his ass and just put a big middle finger to everybody, it'd be my favorite thing.
Oh, that'd be fantastic. Yeah, 100%. He should go to Bellator. They'd let him do it.
Dude, no, just go to Japan. Everybody should just go fight in Ryzen. I'm just trying to rebuild pride over there. It's great.
Yeah.
One last thing I do want to talk about on this fight before we move on to our questions and get out. I don't really have any thoughts in general, but it's the other talking point from the card, and we should at least give it some lip service. Marlon Moraes, the former WSOF bantamweight champion, is making his UFC debut against Rafael dos Anjos, being thrown right into the deep end of the division. What are your thoughts on Moraes making his debut? Are you excited to see Marlon, to see this fight? Do you give a shit? Give me the TNT breakdown.
Eh. There you go.
You're not pro Marlon Moraes?
I don't give a fuck. I think he's a really good fighter, and he can probably do good things. Rafael dos Anjos is a really weird opponent for his first fight, because Rafael dos Anjos is not only really good, but he's almost impossible to look good against. TJ Dillashaw didn't look good against him. You know what I mean? He beat him pretty cleanly, but he didn't look good against him. And he's the kind of fighter who, he doesn't get rocked. He is defensively very sound. Marlon Moraes is going to have a tough time with him. Conversely, if Marlon Moraes finishes him, holy fucking shit. If he can do Marlon Moraes things to him, if he can beat him up, if he can dominate him, if he cleanly beats Rafael dos Anjos, he's really fucking good. But even if he just kind of split decisions dos Anjos, or barely beats him, or 29-28 him, that's a good sign for Marlon Moraes, a really good sign. So don't go out there expecting Moraes to just blow him out of the water. But if he does, yeah.
I mean, you said it most of it in general, except for I'm going to pick a Sunsao. I know Rafael, and so sure, that's very likely coloring my perception. I thought this fight was a weirdest fucking fight for them to make for Marlon Moraes, because, you know, he's not Gaethje with the sort of hype and the kind of natural build of the swell behind him, but he's still a guy that has some people sort of know him. He's an exciting fighter because he's been beating the shit out of extremely mediocre competition, and so like, you could build him better and you can still throw him into the deep end and have him fight somebody, but like you said, there's nobody looks good against Rafael dos Anjos, and I think the best case scenario here is he gets a kind of middling decision win, you know, and then nobody's that pumped about, oh, this big WSOF, because the other end of that is, Not only do people not look good against dos Anjos, nobody fucking knows or gives a shit about Rafael dos Anjos. So not looking good against him is super not an impressive thing to like the casual.
It's like you sign a new lightweight and you put them in there with, say, maybe lightweight's not a good example. You sign a new flyweight and you put them in there with Joseph Benavidez. I mean, it doesn't make any sense, because it's the highest risk matchup with the lowest reward.
Yep. Pretty much.
Except Joseph Benavidez is a lot more famous. Just to say, Joseph Benavidez is more famous and highly regarded than dos Anjos, even though he's not necessarily better, quote unquote. Dos Anjos is really technically solid. He's like a poor man's Jose Aldo in his approach. He is very technical everywhere. He's not Aldo levels of technical everywhere, but he is extremely technical everywhere. He's a very good technical defensive and offensive wrestler. He grapples extremely well. He strikes extremely well. He's a very good counter puncher. He does everything really well. And that's just...
He's also a super nice guy, just in case anybody's wondering.
I'd believe it.
But UFC, that concludes our UFC 212 discussion, unless you are really excited to talk about Shoeface versus Eric Spicely, or any Juan Chagas taking on Judo Jim Wallhead. These tickling your fancy now?
No? Nah, go fuck yourself. But on to fan questions.
On to fan questions. Do you happen to have them in front of you?
Thoughts on Ngannou and his possible showdown with Derek Lewis or Junior Dos Santos? That comes from Alexis, I want to say, Vasquez on Twitter.
Thoughts on Ngannou and his possible showdown against JDS or
Derek Lewis?
Who?
With Derek Lewis or JDS?
I mean, I thought that they were going to make the Derek Lewis and Ngannou fight this go around after they both picked up their last wins, but I sort of envision that, assuming everything goes to plan in their next two fights, Derek Lewis is fighting next weekend, right? Taking on Mark Hunt?
Sure, why not?
I think he's going to lose that fight, probably. Because it's Mark Hunt. I don't know. Fuck, at this point, it's heavyweight MMA and Mark Hunt's 50. But I would favor Ngannou over Derek Lewis. And my head wants to say that I should favor JDS, but I'd pick Ngannou to beat JDS.
Same.
Like, it's one of those things where my head thinks that, like, ooh, JDS, but no. Like, I would pick Ngannou, especially because I'm expecting Ngannou to look better. He's fighting, what, Travis Brown next, isn't that right?
Oh, Jesus, is that true?
I'm fairly confident that he is
fighting.
No,
that can't be true. You keep talking, I'll look that up.
No, I swear he's fighting. I thought that was the case. Maybe I'm wrong. You know, if I just can't, I think he's going to be better, because he's shown massive improvement, you know, fight in and fight out. He's extremely athletic and relatively young for the division. So, I would assume he's going to improve, and I think JDS's best days are probably behind him. So I'd pick him there. Once Stipe slept JDS, my sort of first thought after that was, I wonder how Stipe does against Ngannou in like a year. So that's my take on it. What about you?
Intrinsically, I kind of think that JDS is a really interesting matchup for Ngannou because he is incredibly durable and fast and more technical. And he can keep it standing, and he's fast enough to avoid the big power shots. But, like, I can't get that image out of my mind of JDS just getting dropped with one punch by Stipe. It just keeps coming back, and because of that and nothing else, I'm picking Ngannou in a fight with JDS. It doesn't make all the most sense in the world, but I just can't pick a guy who got flatlined like that against the biggest, power punchiest guy in the UFC. He's way too scary. He's terror personified is what Ngannou is.
It's true. It's true. Yeah.
Moving swiftly forward, Shane Kiley asked, who'd win the fight, Jose Aldo or Max Holloway? Very good question, and I'm hoping we'll get answers to that sometime soon. But as to, I'm gonna take Aldo myself. My head's taking Aldo. Jed?
I'm taking Aldo because, as we've already established, there are levels to the game, and at the highest level, you don't even fight your opponent because you pull out early with weight cutting or injury issues. And we'll get our answer in a couple hours' time. Probably by the time this goes live, people will be listening, and if they turn it on as soon as it drops, they'll be here at this point in the conversation, right as Jose Aldo misses weight, so, or doesn't even weigh in because he goes to the hospital. So. Jose Aldo wins by virtue of playing this game at a much higher level than Max Holloway.
Correct. Someone asked me specifically the question, how many octaves can you sing? And truthfully, even when I try to make my voice go high, I can't really go very high at all. So
try to make your voice go high right now.
I think you should go fuck yourself, but I'm mostly just a baritone bass kind of voiced guy. I don't have very much range. I'm happy enough with that. I'm not going to try. I'm not going to distort my voice. I'd say I have this one octave down pat, and I'm not going to try any of the other octaves.
Listeners, I'm gonna pull back the curtain a little bit here. I hate to be the bearer of bad news. His voice doesn't sound anything like the way you hear it. When I talk to him, he's a squirrely sounding motherfucker, but he insists on making me put his audio through a fucking mixer. So it's all completely fucking different. Dude sounds like he's on helium half the time, but he's all about building his brand. So I'm sorry, guys.
Yeah, I'm actually a 14-year-old internet troll for life. I'll never progress past the age of 14, and my sense of humor will always be at that age, and my interactions online will always be at that age. But it's important that my voice isn't, so I have to have Jed kind of edit up a little bit. Understand?
Yeah, like, why? If it ain't broke, don't fix it. You know, so.
Yeah, so, and since it's broke, you gotta fix it. That's where we're going with this.
Do we have any other questions?
Yeah, there was one or two that I meant to get to. There's two separate threads, so let me take a look at the other one.
I've pulled up one that I've seen linked to me.
Here's one. Why do you always ask for questions but never answer any? Because fuck you, asshole, that's why.
Exactly. You guys ask better fucking questions and we'll answer them.
Who's going to miss weight or get injured before UFC 212? That's a good one.
I'm already on the book saying Jose Aldo's not gonna go to the hospital and not make weight. So
yeah, unfortunately, that's the one that comes to mind first for sure. Like the pullout artist, the pullout merchant, Jose Aldo, the poor guy.
I do want to make a comment on that because I looked at it the other day and like, so Jose Aldo totally has this pullout merchant rap, and like it's not like entirely unfounded because he has pulled out of many a bout in general, but like since coming to the UFC, he's fought in the UFC for 5 years and he's fought 7 times. Like that's not an awful conversion rate for fighting.
True.
It's definitely not bad, but he is like, if you were to ask somebody who's the biggest pullout merchant in MMA, like 100%, it's going to be Jose Aldo. Like Conor branded him that, and he is at that stuck. So good work on Conor, but Aldo gets a little bit of a short shrift on that.
Yeah, he's never escaping that label, unfortunately, and rightfully so. I mean, shit happens, and he's a very injury prone fighter. What can he do? It's not his fault, but. Yeah, I'm not exactly going to criticize anyone for calling him a pullout merchant.
That's true. It's fucking true.
Somebody else asked. I just heard my dogs barking, but I think I quickly muted, so I don't think it messed up.
It did not make it on, so you're good.
Okay, good shit. But somebody else asked, Logical Thinker asked, how did the UFC mess up something so easy, re the women's featherweight division in Cyborg? I'll let you start on that one.
I didn't realize it was easy to have a division with nobody in it, but apparently it is. So,
it's real easy. Mighty Mouse has been doing it for years.
They messed it up by rushing a title and putting it on the winner of a 135-pound bout instead of just giving a title to the only 145-pound fighter in the world that anyone knows or gives a shit about, despite the fact that they had her under contract. They consistently antagonized that same woman for years before putting her on contract to a point that they now have an extremely acrimonious relationship. And she, to be fair to them as well, Chris Cyborg is certainly not the easiest motherfucker in the world to deal with. They've handled it poorly from the jump street because they're secretly not that good at promotion and they've mostly just kind of failed upwards. That's my take.
Yeah, pretty much. Especially like in the WME IMG era, it's kind of hard to. We have to evaluate their decisions differently because it's not the same decision-making body, and so they're new to this, and we're not quite sure what to expect from the decisions. But so far, their decisions seem kind of out of touch, to put it charitably.
That's a very charitable way to put it.
Extremely charitable. I'm like the Bill Gates of UFC criticism. But
actually I'll say this. They're not out of touch. They're misappropriated in that all of their just like if you're a fan at this point and you look at the UFC and you think, what the fuck are they doing? Basically the answer to it is they're in a desperate cash grab because they owe an enormous amount of money because they overpaid for a fucking product. And now they're trying to leverage anything they can to make money until they get this new TV deal in 2019. And hopefully that will kind of get them back on track, but maybe that won't even fucking help because the TV rights might not be worth shit anymore.
Yeah, true. I think I'm not sure if that's the last of the fan questions. Might be, might not be. I don't really give a fuck. But I have a question.
Answered many.
Yeah, that's true. I have a question for the fans. If anyone knows how we can legally use the song September by Earth, Wind & Fire as our intro, just let me know, because that would be a great intro. That's the catchiest song. Or outro. Perfect outro. Can't get better than that.
I'm okay with that. I think we can use it.
I've seen YouTubers using it. That's why. Because I think it's awesome. Do you remember?
I saw your tweet today. I'm for that being our intro and outro song.
Oh, it's perfect.
I'll see if I can put that on this
one. September.
Yeah, look into it. It's very catchy. I'm in on that. We can definitely try to do that. I'll see if I can get that up on this one.
Good shit.
That is everything for this week.
By the way, if you can get me that song as our outro, you get to keep your job, and I'll call off the whole come to me if you want to be a podcast co-host on Twitter thing.
Look, if somebody else wants to do it, I'm not going to fight you over it.
They don't know what they're getting themselves into, Jed.
They have no fucking idea. That does it for us this week, folks. Glad to be back. We will see about maybe doing a reaction show live, do like a Google Hangout or something on for UFC 212, depending on our level of drunk and or stonedness. And other than that, we should be back to regularly scheduled programming. If we don't do an immediate reaction, we will definitely have a show up next week to talk about UFC 212 and all the goings on.
Definitely, guys. Don't worry about it.
100%, and it will be 100%. And it will be introed by Earth, Wind, and Fire, and it will just be perfect.
Yeah, we're gonna have guests on, like we said we would. The website's going up.
The website's gonna be up. We're gonna be on iTunes. Don't worry, guys. Everything's coming up the naked truth next week. I believe. I'm an optimist at heart.
Let's just cut it off now with lies and laughter. Let's just leave it at that.
It has been real, guys. I am Jed Meshew. He is the Naked Gambler. We'll talk to you later.
Take care, guys.